Nearly 50 million women falling into poverty, an absolutely staggering number. Well, I talked about that recently with Melinda Gates, who is co-chair of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And I began by asking her how exactly women are being disproportionately impacted during this COVID crisis. Have a listen to our discussion.
Well, we're seeing, I mean, when you think of 47 million women, that's like the entire country of Spain falling into poverty. And so why is it women? It's because we're seeing women drop out of the labor force in droves. And it's really because of two reasons. One is this unpaid caregiving and work that they do. And the other is because they are represented quite often in these more fragile informal sectors. And that's where jobs are being lost and people aren't going out and getting services or going to their restaurant or going into the hospitality industry. And so, yes, women are falling into poverty because they are literally leaving the workforce in enormous numbers.
And that is clear, correct? We are physically seeing that fallout at this point.
Yes. Two-thirds of the jobs lost in South Africa were lost by women. 1 million of the more jobs lost in the United States were by women versus men. All of the jobs lost in the United States in December were women's jobs. So when women come out of the workforce, it means they're going to be much slower to go back, and it means we're going to have a much slower economic recovery. I mean, government after government around the world wants women to work because they know they get a more robust economy if women work. So this is a crisis that we need to address as a world.
And we are talking on a global basis. You wrote in a Bloomberg opinion piece, February the 18th, quote, as countries respond to the biggest challenge of our generation, they should view women as central builders of a stronger post-COVID world. What can governments then do to address the unique challenges women are facing globally and better unlock their economic potential?
Sure. So governments need to stop thinking of women as this side or nice to do issue and realize it is the central issue. It's the infrastructure you have to build back. And so we have to look at three things, and governments are starting to do this. They have to look at the caregiving work that women do, the unpaid caregiving work. That is 30 hours a week globally for women. So that's almost a full-time job. We have to address that sector, the unpaid work that's happening and the caregiving. Secondly, we need to realize that women are in these informal jobs around the world. And so we need to do things like digitize social payments to them to support them during this time. And third, we need to look at women's jobs and realize that women-led businesses are some of the most new and fragile in the economy, and there are things we need to do to prop up those women-led businesses so they don't collapse and go away. And I'm seeing governments do that in country after country. Look at those three areas.
Where are you seeing this sort of, quote, enlightened policy?
Well, we're seeing it in some countries, like the U.S. is finally realizing its childcare sector is collapsing. And so in the most recent stimulus bill, they're putting $10 billion into the childcare sector. The U.S. is finally talking about having a real unpaid family medical leave policy, which every other high-income nation has. So you're seeing it there. You're seeing it in terms of the informal sector. I'm seeing more governments digitize payment. India got 200 million digital payments out to women. Indonesia got digital payments out. Nigeria got digital payments out. And then in the area of women-led businesses, I'm seeing countries like Burkina Faso and others on the continent of Africa say, we need to relieve women-led businesses of their water and utility fees so that they can stay open and not have that pressure. I'm seeing countries like Canada say, we're going to put our economic recovery money into women-led businesses and women entrepreneurs. Those are the kinds of things that can be done.
There's been an awful lot of debate. In fact, it's an age-old debate, isn't it, about whether female leaders do a better job in protecting lives and livelihoods during the pandemic, and whether it is critical to see women in positions of leadership as we begin to rebuild societies and help facilitate other women who are being disproportionately impacted. Let's start with the first part of that. You know, do women leaders do a better job? And if so, how?
Well, all we've got to do is look at two countries. Look at how Germany responded to this crisis under Chancellor Angela Merkel. Look at how New Zealand has done under Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern. Those women ask the right questions. They lead from the science and the data and thinking about everyone else. When I was on the phone with both of those women early in the pandemic and their countries were doing well, they were thinking already of the spots they weren't doing well and how their most vulnerable and fragile people in their society needed to still reach services. And so this question of, do women do a better job? You could look at those two leaders, that's leadership.
In economies which are being heavily impacted and don't have the sort of, you know, traditional infrastructure to make what we are talking about here work, what do you want to see and what support do countries need at this point?
So they need governments from high-income countries to support their health systems. And I'll give you the example of Ebola. We saw in the four affected countries with Ebola that the crisis in the healthcare system meant that women didn't go for services. And so they were afraid to go, or if the maternity clinic wasn't separated from the Ebola part of the clinic, it wasn't safe for them to go to deliver babies. And so we saw much higher maternal mortality during that time. We saw more unplanned pregnancies because women couldn't get their contraceptives. That meant more teenagers not going to school and having babies. So we need to support those fragile health systems so they stay up and running and people can go into them when they are sick or a family member is sick.
Sadly, the pandemic has wreaked havoc on education globally. As I understand it, over 800 million students now remain out of school, and millions, of course, do not have access to remote learning. In the developed world, we are beginning to see plans about getting kids back into school. But look, that is not happening all over the world. And indeed, even before the pandemic, wasn't happening all over the world. Just how important are the long-term impacts from the loss of education? And how could it, to your mind, erode the decades of work that has been done in fighting poverty, Melinda?
Yeah, 800 million children out of school is a tragedy because those are kids who won't go on to learn, to think of new ideas. And quite often when kids leave the schoolroom, the last ones to come back, and again, we learned this from Ebola, are the girls. And so we're gonna see a setback, we could, of a generation of girls who would have lifted themselves and their families out of poverty. And it's vitally important we look at that. One of the reasons I brought up unpaid labor earlier is if you take one of the larger childcare providers in East Africa, Kadogo, they estimate that 60% of their families who no longer bring their babies in for kids in for childcare, they're relying on their adolescent daughter to take care of those kids. And that means she then doesn't go back to school. That's a tragedy. And that is something we've got to address as a world.
The pandemic has hit the world at a time when we were beginning to have a grown-up conversation about the impact of climate change on all of us, wherever we live, be it where you are in the States, where I am here in Abu Dhabi, in the UAE, wherever our viewers are watching from. Your husband, Bill Gates, has written a new book, How to Avoid Climate Disaster. I should note that while promoting it, he has faced some criticism from the media about the use of private jets. But in an interview with Fox, Bill said it is completely unrealistic for the world to eliminate emissions by 2030, but that reaching zero net emissions by 2050 is achievable. Within the context of this interview on International Women's Day, I just want to discuss the message that you have from your foundation that I know goes like the following: climate change will dwarf the pandemic in terms of eventual fatalities and global impact. Just talk me through what plans your foundation has to work with governments and business in order to fight this crisis.
Well, in terms of our foundation's role, we're really looking at climate adaptation strategies for farmers. And more than half the world's farmers are women, and that's their primary source of income. So how do you make sure they have drought-resistant seeds if they live on the edge of the Sahel? The Sahel Desert is moving down, as we know. How do you make sure they have flood-resistant seeds? Because the farmers will tell you the rains are coming much more often, or sometimes they're coming less often, but when they come, it's a ginormous flood all at once. And so they need to have seeds, and they need to be prepared for that and understand and have mechanisms for learning more about when are the rains coming? How do we get information out there? So we're looking at all those types of adaptation strategies on the way to the world getting to zero emissions by 2050, because they are the ones most impacted, which are people who are in poverty.